Very good morning to all. So let's start today's lecture. We had seen few topics yesterday. I will just quickly brush up once and then I will start with today's topics. We had seen what are the various targeted malicious codes. Okay, we started off with Salami attack. I gave an example of what exactly Salami attack is. In fact, a very detailed example in which we had taken few real life cases. What exactly is rounding off? I had discussed about that and how exactly we people are being cheated by companies or multinational companies, I would say, by using the simple technique of rounding off. And if we encounter any such thing in real life, we should always raise a dispute against that because it's our hard-earned money and we don't want to give it away. Okay, we shouldn't give it away for free. So next up, after learning about what Salami attack exactly is, we started off with covert channels. I also gave few examples of what exactly is a covert channel, right? And after that, these two examples I had discussed. For example, this particular technique of common storage, in which a common folder can be shared between various entities or various users, and they can think of an arrangement using which they can communicate with each other. Okay, similarly, I also talked about an example of a Morse code where a criminal present inside a jail was able to communicate with his or her partners outside that jail. Okay, obviously through insiders, otherwise it would not be possible. Okay, I will also show a small video of what exactly is covert channel, 2 or 3 minutes video. Okay, after that, we saw what exactly is linearization attack. We came to know that if any vulnerability is present in a program, for example, in this program, there was a vulnerability that the program used to come out of the loop whenever any incorrect guess was made. Okay, so what exactly happened is the attacker used to keep on guessing the various characters. If the first character matches with the already existing value over here, that is S, then only the program will take a longer amount of time. Otherwise, it will simply move out of the loop. So using this simple technique, the attacker basically used to keep track of the timing, that is the time taken for executing one particular character. And at the end, he or she came to know that the particular character S was taking the most amount of time. So he or she came to the conclusion that S is the correct guess. So keeping that character S constant, the attacker then tried all other combinations for the second character and so on. This process continued. So whichever character took the longest time, it was guessed to be the correct character. So in this fashion, one by one, the attacker can recover the password one character at a time. So this is all about the targeted malicious codes, Salami attack, covert channel, and linearization attack. So let me show you a quick video. Okay.
So let's learn what a covert.
I will open it in, for example, Chrome if possible. Just give me 2 minutes. First,
so let's learn.
Kindly let me know if it's audible. If not audible, then I will try to open it in Chrome.
Audible, sir.
Okay, fine.
What a covert channel is. A covert channel refers to a communication mechanism used to transfer information through a not normally used or unintended path or means. The immediate goal here is to, of course, avoid detection when malicious party is trying to transfer information, and the ultimate goal is to bypass, violate, and circumvent any sort of security policies by doing so. The opposite of a covert channel is an overt channel, in which you use a known, expected, authorized, monitored, designated, and controlled channel to transfer data or information. So I have this Chinese word here, simply meaning opening up everything. There are different types of covert channels. One of the types is covert timing channel, which takes advantage of the performance of a system component to send a secret message or a system's resources timing to do the same. Another type is the covert storage channel. In this case, the mechanism used to send the secret message is this common storage area between processes in the memory, the main memory of your system. So how do we prevent covert channels? The only way is really vigilance in this case by doing your auditing, by doing your due diligence through such things as auditing and by also checking the log files and so on. There is this very famous example of using a covert channel by this person, Jeremiah Denton. He was a prisoner of war, and when he was interviewed, he was using his winking to send Morse code to secretly say that he wasn't very happy. In fact, he sent a message, tortured by winking. Another example of a covert channel could be somehow using the sizes of your file. So in this case, the content of the file doesn't really matter because the message you're trying to send here is really done through the size of the file.
So I hope you got a brief idea of what exactly covert channels are. So the last two examples were of importance. One we have already seen, the Morse coding, and the other one, the last one which you saw was the file size. In fact, any content present inside a file doesn't matter. The only thing is you would like to convey the size of the file. For example, I create a text file and I fill up any garbage values inside it, but make sure that the size is, for example, given in the video, it was 16 KB. So if you want to share some information, for example, 16 or anything of that sort, you have to keep the size of the file around 16 or 15 point something. So basically, the contents inside the file doesn't matter. So whoever receives that file will open that file to check actually what is present inside the file. But the covert channel in this case is not the file itself. It is the file size. Okay. So this is how we can fool the people using any undetected medium of communication. So that is what we call a covert channel. So these are the three things which we have seen so far. In the last lecture also, we had done a thorough understanding of what exactly these three topics were. Now let's start with today's session. We had already seen these three types in yesterday's lecture. That is, operating system security has these three functions, that is separation, then memory protection, and access control. So we have already seen what is separation. If you want, I will give you a quick recap. Separation can be done in several ways. Separation is nothing but separating the various users and the objects that they can refer. For example, physical separation was all about physically separating or keeping different hardware units for different users. I gave an example of a printer. We can have multiple printers for printing purpose. For example, you take a lot of time during your submissions. So instead of a single printer, we can have five or six printers in a lab so that the crowd could be easily spread across those five printers. So this is what we call as physical separation. Second one was temporal separation, means using a particular resource for a particular amount of time. For example, I wish to access a resource. I wish to access a computer for 30 minutes. So that 30 minute will be my time slice. And once I finish my time quantum of 30 minutes, the other user will replace me and they will be using that particular resource. So in this case, the resource is constant, resource is same, but you are being provided a particular time slice for using that particular resource, right? So that was temporal separation. Next up, we learned about what is logical separation. Logical separation is nothing but creating logical units or virtual units of the physical items. For example, sharing a single OS among, using three OSs parallelly inside a particular OS. For example, I'm running Microsoft Windows Microsoft Windows 10. Okay, so inside Windows 10, I can run Ubuntu. Inside Windows 10, I can run Kali or any other variant of an OS. So what I'm doing is I'm having one master OS inside which I'm running two or three virtual OSs. So I'm creating a virtual section by separating my entire hard disk and my RAM and distributing it to those virtual units. So again, the usage is the physical unit is only one constant, but I'm creating virtual units of that particular physical unit and distributing it among multiple users. That is what we call as logical separation. And lastly, we saw what is cryptographic separation. In this case, all the users will be sharing the same medium. They will be using the same file system. As well, they will be using the same storage medium. But one user is separated from any other user with the help of cryptography. Why? Because if I create a file, I will make sure that I encrypt that file with any encryption algorithm. For example, RSA or AES or any strong encryption algorithm. What this will make sure is any other unintended user will not be able to access my file without having that particular private key. So out of all these four techniques, I told you, if you remember, that the fourth one is the strongest or is the most useful. And after that, logical separation was useful. So far, we had done in the previous lecture. So I just had a recap of what we had done so far so that I can collate it with today's concepts. Okay. So any doubts so far? Can I start with today's lecture?
No doubt, sir.
Okay, thank you. So let's start with the next topic, which is memory protection. Over here, you can see security functions of OS are separation, memory protection, and access control. So let's start with memory protection. As access control, we have already done in our previous chapter. So I won't be focusing on that. If you remember, we had done two types of access controls, MAC and DSC. Mandatory access control and discretionary access control. So we have already covered that topic. So let's start with memory and address protection. So basically, memory and address protection can be done with the help of these five techniques or these five concepts, which are as follows. First one is fencing. So now I will go slow. So far I was just revising, so I just went at a bullet speed. So now I will keep my pace low. So what do we mean as a fence? What do you mean by fence? Basically, fence is nothing but a boundary or a boundary wall which keeps our resources secure at our side of the boundary. Okay, so if we want to secure a particular resource, we would like to have a boundary or a fencing around our resource or around our property. Similarly, our compound walls, our college has a compound wall, our houses or buildings might have, societies might be having compound walls. So basically, to keep outsiders away, we require the concept of a fence. Same thing is applied in an operating system as well. I will come to it. Okay, so it is basically having two variants. First of all, I will discuss the first variant, which is called as fixed fencing. Just have a look at this diagram and then try to tell me what exactly is happening. Without even looking at the other diagram, I'm just focusing on this particular diagram. Fixed fencing. Just have a look once and try to tell me what exactly is happening. Okay, any ideas? What is happening over here? Yeah.
Yes, sir. Sir, इसने restrictive मतलब restrictions लगा दिए. मतलब the operating system can only be allocated to 0 to A and user program can only be allocated from N plus 1 to I. मतलब और अगर user program को अगर ज़्यादा space allocate करना है या फिर वो ज़्यादा space require करता है तो उसको मिलेगा नहीं सर. Whereas same with the operating system too.
Correct. So basically we are restricting the actual space between operating system and the user program space. So we are restricting the operating system from 0 to n location and n plus 1 to the highest location, whichever what is the highest bound of that memory. We are allocating that for the user program space. Okay, so I have few answers. Separate memory is reserved for the OS and user. Correct. OS and user space is fixed and with hardware address limitations. Correct. So the same concept is applied over here. We are limiting the operating system and the user program space. We are restricting their access. So let me read out from the book, from the reference book. Offense is basically a method which is used to confine the users to one side of the boundary. So I'm just using the bookish language. It is used to confine the users, confine or restrict the users to one side of the boundary. Okay. So in a fixed fence mechanism, there is a hardware address limitation. You can see this is a hardware address limitation, which divides the actual memory, into two sections. 0 to N is being allocated to the operating system, and N plus 1 to high will be allocated to the whole address range that the user can use. Okay, so any drawbacks of this particular technique? Any drawbacks you can see? First of all, let's not talk about drawbacks. First of all, let's focus on the positive things in this particular model. The positive things are that none of the user program can interfere with the operating system. For example, if any buffer overflow happens, that will happen inside the user program space, because first of all, the OS will check whether the starting address of the user program is somewhere between N plus 1 or high. If by chance the user begins at a point which is less than N, what will happen? The OS will simply reject that user program's request, because it will be having an address range. If it is having an address range something less than N, it will simply say that that belongs to the operating system address space. So I can't allocate that address space to the user program. So this is one of the main strength of this particular model, which is called as fixed fence mechanism. But on the other hand, if the user program space runs out of space, basically the user program is very huge and it runs out of memory, then what can happen? Then what will happen in this case? If it is of utmost importance, it is a high priority user program which needs to run on this machine, but still it is not able to run because it is running out of memory. So in that case, will this model be able to address that situation or not? Kindly acknowledge. I'm repeating the question once again. If I wish to run a program which is of very high priority and I want it to run anyhow, but it has a huge memory which cannot accommodate inside the user program space, in such a case, will this model be able to address such a situation? No. So why it won't be able to handle? Because we have fixed the limits. 0 to N hua to OS ke andar hi aayega, N plus 1 to high hua to hi user program space mein jayega. You're getting? So this limitation will add up and we won't be able to address such a situation. Hence, that program will be rejected and it won't be able to run. This is the major drawback of this particular model. That's why to overcome this, the second model came into existence, which is also called as version 2. Version 2 is nothing but variable fence mechanism. Now have a look at this diagram and tell me the difference between both of these. It looks exactly similar with few changes, very minor changes, but they are equally important changes. Have a look. Yes, we are talking about version 2. Version 2 is a variable fence mechanism. The changes over here. Instead of N, we have written P, but what is that P? Baki ko change nahi hai, no other changes present over here. Instead of N, I have written P, but why this P and what is this P exactly? The major drawback of the previous case was whether, let me show you once again parallelly, okay, whether the operating system uses only, if the operating system uses this much space, this remaining space gets wasted, right? So to overcome this issue, it was felt that instead of a fixed mechanism, fixed fence mechanism, we can have a variable fence mechanism. Okay, for example, if the operating system requires only this much space, then this particular pointer P can be moved upward or can be varied or can be basically we can slide the pointer. So in this case, P is nothing but a pointer. That pointer will basically point to the last location of the operating system. Hence, zero will be starting from the address zero and it will range till address pointer P. So till P, there will be the operating system installed. It will be requiring this much space. And after P, that is from P plus 1 to high, that much space can be used by the user or the user program. You're getting? Understood? So basically, one more thing lies over here. We are not bothered. We are not looking whether the user is requiring any particular program to run or not. The main criteria is it depends entirely on the OS. We are not giving full privilege to the user. Otherwise, what will happen is, for example, this OS requires this much space. Itna minimum lagne hi wala hai usko. Still, if the user requires this much extra space, it will not happen so that the user is allocated this space. Why? Because if we allocate this much space to the user, the extra space which the operating system uses will not be usable. You are trying to understand what I'm trying to say. The entire concept depends upon the operating system. Entire control is with the operating system. Wherever the operating system execution finishes, from that much point till the highest point will be allocated to the user. That's why it's called variable. Variable ka ye meaning nahi hai ki user ko jab bhi space lagega usko provide kar diya jayega. You're getting what I'm trying to say. Bhale user ko space ki zarurat hai, but the first thing is the operating system will check whether it can allocate that much space or not. That is why we are saying ki this is also called as a security mechanism. That is why it is also called as memory and address protection. Because if we provide access to each and every user to the OS, then what will happen? The operating system files may get replaced by the user files. That we don't want. Variable fence mechanism ka ye matlab nahi hai ki jab bhi user ko kuch space lagega, that will be provided. First of all, it will be checked whether the operating system can allocate that much space to the user or not. If the operating system is in a position to allocate that much space, then only the sliders will move upward and that much space will be given to the user. This entire mechanism was not available in this case. Hence, the previous one or version one was called as fixed mechanism and this is called as a variable fence mechanism. So is it clear now? Kindly let me know. This might sound a little confusing, but the concept should be clear. Okay. So again, I got an answer from Abhijit previously that user program is, if the user program is more than the user program space of the OS will be used to occupy the user space. Okay. The same thing I explained, that is why I explained this particular point that even if the user requires more space, it won't be given the space automatically. First, it will be checked whether it can be given or not by the OS. If the OS feels that particular space is extra, it won't require that space for running all the operating system processes, then only that particular pointer can be slid upward and that much resources can be given to the user program. Clear? So I hope this is clear now. This was the first type, which is called as fence. Let's move ahead with the second type. The second type is called as relocation. As explained earlier, yesterday also, whenever we write a program, we assume that it always starts from the zeroth location, okay, or the address zero. But does it always happen so? Because we know that the main memory is divided into multiple fragments, multiple sections, multiple pages, segmentation and paging we are going to learn later. So it is basically scattered. You are not sure which memory location you will get for running that particular program, for executing that particular program, because we are not sure until the actual execution of that program begins. We are not in a position to tell that until the actual program is loaded into the memory and executed. Samajh rahe what I'm trying to say? It is not always sure that the execution of that particular program will always begin from address zero. It might begin from address 103 or 1003 or 101. Wherever the memory is free, the execution of that particular process will begin from that particular location. That's why what we need to do is, whenever we load a program into the memory, okay, from whichever location that particular execution begins, we need to add that offset address to the program's base address. For example, the program's base address may be beginning from zero, right? And the offset address may be 1003. For example, the execution is beginning from 1003. So what we should do, the actual address will be this base address plus offset address. That is, it will be beginning from 1003. You're getting what I'm trying to say. So what exactly I'm doing is, I'm relocating the program, which was ideally assumed to be beginning from zeroth location, to this location, that is 1003. So I'm relocating the base address to the offset address. Now let me tell you the definition of this particular concept. Can we make use of the fence register for carrying out this activity? Can we make use of the variable fence or the fixed fence, whatever you wish to? Can we make use of it? Variable preferably. Yes or no? Kindly go through the concept once again. Can we make use of the fixed fence or variable fence register to add the offset address? Because there has to be some logical entity, there has to be some logical logical concept which we can use. Otherwise, hawa mein tum log aise nahi bol sakte, kuch bhi address utha ke dal do. We need some concept, we need some strong backing. So can we make use of this P pointer or this particular variable fence mechanism to indicate the offset? Yes or no? Kindly go through the diagram once again. I'm giving you an example. Okay. I'm writing it over here. For example, if the memory address is 1000, okay, and your program had a location of 0, 1, 2... then it has to be recomputed to, now you only tell me, what will be the new addresses? It will be recomputed to which address? Correct, we can use the pointer as offset. So in this case, the memory address is nothing but, from here, the actual execution should begin. So this is nothing but your P value, yes or no? Or you can say P plus 1, sorry, because it is starting from P plus 1th location. So this is nothing but your P plus 1th location. We are assuming that no program is present at this particular moment. So can you tell me what is the offset over here? What is the base address over here? And how to obtain the actual address? Which of these is the offset address and which of these is the base address? I have purposely written it out of sequence. You only tell me what is the base address, what is the offset address, and what should be the actual address. If this is clear, then segmentation concept will be very clear. 1000 is the offset, correct? So 1000 will be your offset, and 0, 1, and 2 respectively will be your base address. Yes or no? So if we want to find out the actual address, it will be this plus this, this plus this, this plus this. Because we can't change the value of P plus 1 or P. So actual addresses will be 1000, 1001, 1002, and so on. Clear? Now I hope you got this particular concept. So we are making use of the variable fence, or you can say a fixed fence also in that case. It doesn't matter. We are simply making use of the fence. Instead of P plus 1, you can even write N plus 1. It doesn't matter which method you're using. It should be a fence variable. That's it. It should be a fence register. That's it. Clear? So I hope you got what exactly is this concept relocation is all about. Are you having any doubt? If you're having any doubt, kindly let me know. Okay, because these concepts carry 10 marks weightage. So you have to write all these five types. If a question is asked on how to protect the memory and address of an operating system, then you need to write all these five techniques. There is one more technique, tagged architecture. I will focus upon that if I get time. It's a very simple technique. If you skip that, even that is fine. So I haven't written it over here, but if I get time, I will explain that also. So till now we have done these two topics, fence and relocation. If it is clear, kindly acknowledge so that I can move ahead with the third type, base bound register.
Yes, sir.
Okay. What about others? Sirf do teen log hi answer dete. Okay. Thank you so much. So next, let's move towards the next topic, which is called as base and bound register. So it's again similar in concept, but this time you can see I have divided the user space into multiple regions. Can you tell me what exactly is happening over here? I have zoomed it up for you. I've divided the user space into multiple sections. 0 to N belongs to operating system. Then N plus 1 to P belongs to first user, P plus 1 to Q belongs to second user, and Q plus 1 to highest position belongs to the third user, user C. So can you tell me how is this made possible? We always had one pointer, we always had one register, which is called as your fixed register or variable fence register, fixed fence or variable fence. We have seen this much so far. So we were always making use of one register, but in this case you can see that there are two registers displayed. One is called as the base register, which will obviously tell you the base point. Base point is nothing but the point from where the user can actually start its operations, or you can simply say the offset from where the actual user space begins. In this case, the user space is beginning from N plus 1, right, and it is extending till highest point. But this entire space is being divided into multiple user spaces, which is user A, user B, user C. So we are doing some kind of virtualization or logical separation. Okay, how we are making that possible? With the help of another register, which is called as bound register. So bound register is a concept which can be used to define the bounds of a particular user. For example, you can see over here, at this point of time, user A is executing the memory, and hence the base register will be N plus 1 and the bound register will be P, because at this point user A is using that space. Similarly, if user B wants to use the space, what will happen is this particular slider or this particular window will slide below, okay, and now the base register will be P plus 1 and the bound register will be Q. You're getting what I'm trying to say? For the user B, the base register will be P plus 1 and the bound register will be Q. Similarly, if the user C wants to use the space, again the base and bound register will have to be slided down. So it now becomes base register will be Q plus 1 and the bound register will be I. You got what I'm trying to say? This is the concept which comes really handy when you want to divide your entire space among multiple users at the same time. So whichever user wants to use that particular space can make use of that pointers to specify a particular region, particular position where that particular user can work upon. This everything is done by the OS only. The user has no say in that. The OS only decides whether it should provide the access to the user B or user C at that point of time. For example, user B has a program which needs to be written into the main memory. The user compiles the program and the OS at the back end will check whether that particular program can be fit into the memory. It will first check in the first user space. Okay, if it is free, that program can be entered into this particular area. But if it is not free, the base and bound register will be slided down to check whether user B space is free. Again, if user B is also not free, the final space will be checked, which is user C. If it will be entered here, otherwise that particular program will have to wait till any particular free space is created. You got what I'm saying? This is how we make use of base and bounds register. Okay, so let me let me just read out from the book. I'm using this reference book. Okay, I have already shared the PDF of all the reference books with you all. So kindly go through the reference book. solves the problem. This is an allocation register, right? So a variable friends register in this case is this particular variable friends register. It makes the it makes the memory space available to be executed by all the users at the same time. Okay. I'm just dictating what exactly is the first register called as bound register, and then what about the second? First is base and second is bound. Okay. So can anyone tell me the definition of the base register in this case? Any idea what is the base register and what is the bound register? How you will write in your exams? That is of main concern, because what you know so far is what is a fixed register or what is a fence register. But what exactly is the base register? Any idea? Kindly let me know. What does the base register signify? This is my question. If I ask you in the question, in the exam, kindly define what is a base register, then how will you define it? Similarly, I would be asking, what is a bound register? How will you define it? Okay. Base is the starting address of a particular user. Not a particular user, it is basically the starting address of the user space where the execution of a user program can begin. We can say that user area. Okay, so let me write it for you. Base register n plus 1 is the start of user area, or starting address is the starting address of user area. Clear? I have written in short. Similarly, what would be the bound register? What is the bound register? Base to abhi sabko pata chal gaya. What is a base? Base is the starting address. N plus 1 is the starting address of the user area. What will be the bounds register? It's bounds. Bound or bounds, whatever. Kindly let me know, kindly acknowledge. Don't be so dull. Actual starting address? Nahi. Have a look once again, Rishikesh. What is base and what is bound? Have a look at the diagram once again. Base se start ho raha hai. Base is the actual starting address of user space. What is bound? Ending address, correct. It is the last address. So I can say that it is the upper address limit of the address space. It is denoted by P. For example, if I'm considering user space A, so hence I'm writing P. P is the actual upper limit. Or even if you skip the word actual, you can simply say that bounds register, for example, in this case P, is an upper space or an upper address limit of the user space. Upper address limit of the user address space or of the user area, whatever you may wish to call it. So kindly make a note, diagram you can see again once again. Base register is the actual starting address of user area, and bounds register is the actual upper address of the user area or the upper limit of the user area, or the end address, whatever you wish to call it. Clear now? So this is how the base and bounds register can be made use of whenever we wish to extend our user space well beyond the allocated space. Clear with this? These three types. First one was fence, second relocation, and third is base bounds register. Clear? So can I move ahead? Okay, thank you so much. Next topic is segmentation. You all might be aware of it. Kal maine bola bhi tha, kindly read and come. So I will look at this particular diagram. Take 1 or 2 minutes maximum, go through this diagram, and then try to explain what exactly is happening. I can ask any one of you to kindly go through the diagram and be prepared. Maximum 2 minutes time I'm giving, so prepare it. In the meantime, I will drop in the attendance link. We still have 20 minutes time with us. So we are going to cover these two topics, segmentation and paging. Take 2 minutes, go through this diagram, and then let me know what exactly is happening. Is it done? Is it clear? Can anyone tell me what exactly is happening? Or else I will point out names from this particular chat room. Okay. Kindly let me know if you got the concept of segmentation. We already know what is segmentation, right? You have seen what is a segment. Physical address space is divided into different memory segments of various sizes, correct? Which are available for users at different addresses. Okay, right? It is basically the division of physical addresses. Division, you can say, yeah. In this case, you can see that there are on the right side in the physical address space, it is scattered. We are not sure which particular segment will come first and then which particular segment will be followed by that. Similarly, on the left hand side, you can see that there is a logical address space which will be having the names of all these segments. Okay, we are having for this particular example, we are having 5 segments, and those 5 segments are named as segment 0 to segment 4. Okay, but they need to have some addresses also. Otherwise, basically, you can term this as an index where each segment will be having a particular address space from where it will begin execution. Okay, Dhruval has an answer, process that creates address spaces of various sizes in a computer system called segments. Okay, similar kind of an answer. So the middle table, you can see that it is being divided into two columns, base address and limit. So what is the base address and what is the limit? Any idea? We have already seen today only. We added some value to the offset, sorry, to the base address. Sorry. So what is this limit? This limit is nothing but the offset. You remember we did this in the fence register, the same thing. That's why I was focusing on that for a long duration. This limit is nothing but the offset address. In the first case, you can see that segment 0 starts from the base address 500 and it has a limit, or I can say it has an offset. Okay. It has an offset of 600. So what will happen from 500 till 600 units, that is 500 plus 600, till 1100, the segment 0 will be residing on the main memory. Similarly, the next segment 1 is starting from base address 2500. So over here you can see where base 1 will be starting from. Immediately the location will be present after this. You can see after segment 0, segment 1 is not beginning, segment 2 is beginning. Why? Because segment 1 has an address which is present somewhere below. Which is present somewhere below, that is 2500. So segment 1 is beginning from 2500 location till 800 more addresses. So it is extending till 3300. So that is what is the importance of segmentation, because anywhere in the main memory or in the physical address space, there would be vacant spaces. That vacant space can be utilized by the operating system to allocate it to the processes. So in this case, we have divided the entire region into 5 segments, and whichever space is available, that particular location is allocated to those files or those user area, what you can say, data. For example, what could be the contents of these segments? Any idea what can be present inside those segments? And how do we access a particular segment? You have done it in your operating system subject. Try to recollect it. Try to think of it. How could we access a particular segment? We can't simply call a segment directly. We need some kind of a nomenclature. We need some kind of a syntax for accessing those segments. How can we access a segment? In this case, are there any unique things or unique value which is differentiating the various segments? Address, okay, no. What else? Think of it. First, tell me how can we access them, and then you have to tell me what can be present inside those segments. Base address, okay. Can we call a segment using only a single value or using only a single parameter? It has to be a combination, right? Simply think of it. Simply think of it. What are those parameters? What are those combinations? There is a pair. if you remember, you had done it, might be you have forgotten it. There is a pair which is bolo. Any address, any idea, any answers?
Base plus offset, sir?
Correct. Instead of base and offset, we are going to call it as name and offset. Name could be the segment name. So basically, mera naam aur main kahan pe present hu, kahan pe rehta hu, that is the offset. Naam is basically this particular value. If you refer segment 0, for example, I'm just giving an example. For example, see over here, I wish to access segment 0. I would be giving something like this, segment 0 slash offset. Offset is nothing but this value. So 600. So what will happen is this segment 0 will be checked. Segment 0 will be checked in this particular table. Okay, this particular value. Now over here, segment 0 has a different name. What is that name? Segment 0. Over here, you can see, I have not written the complete thing over here. This is segment 0, segment 1, segment 2, segment 3, and segment 4. Okay. Space ka shortage tha, toh yaha pe likha nahi hai. It is not 0, it is segment 0, segment 1, segment 2, segment 3, and segment 4. So what happens is, segment 0 will be checked over here. Now we know that segment 0 has a base address of 500. So from this, it will be pointed over this particular value, this is 500. Correct? What is the offset? Offset is 600. So hence, this is basically a pointer table. We can refer any segment using this technique, that is the name of that segment followed by the offset value. Okay. So offset obviously has to be known beforehand, because without knowing how much space that particular segment is occupying, you won't be able to enter the data in that segment. So for example, if I wish to access segment number 3, I would be writing it like this: segment 3 space the offset would be, what is the offset? 200, right? So using this, I will simply, this particular instruction will simply refer this table, and then it will check that the base address of segment 3 is 4600. So it will simply point to 4600, and from that location, 200 more spaces will be occupied to fill the segment 3 data. Clear? Why we are doing this? Why we are learning about this? Because this basically applies some sort of security on the operating system, because we are predefining the space required for a particular segment. As a result, we are also predefining or mentioning that this particular segment should begin at this address only. So there is no chance that this particular segment will overflow that particular memory space and go into some adjacent location. Is it possible? No, because we are also giving the base register, that is 4600 in this case, as well as bounds register, that is 4800 in this case. You can correlate with the previous case. This is similar to this. The same concept of base and bounds is being applied over here. That is why I had focused on the base register and bounds register for a long duration of time. Clear with this now, how exactly segmentation works and why it is required for securing the operating systems? Any doubts so far? Okay, so can we proceed ahead with the last topic of the day, that is paging? Yes, okay, thank you so much. Concept similar to segmentation is present over here, which is called as paging. Again, refer the diagram and let me know what exactly is the difference between this segmentation and paging. The diagram looks almost same, but there is a difference. You might have seen this concept. You might have seen the difference of this also in the previous few semesters. Hirsch has an answer. Paging is a storage used to retrieve the processes from the secondary storage into the main memory in the form of pages. Okay, correct. What else? Basic difference between a page and a segment. Okay, that is there. In paging, the memory is divided into pages. If I rename the segments as page, it doesn't mean segmentation gets converted to paging. There has to be some difference. Obviously, in paging, we divide the memory into pages. That is a difference. But what about the main difference? Any particular concept which you are missing over here? Correct? Correct. That is what I was trying to find out. Segmentation is of variable sizes. A segment can be of variable size, but paging a page is of same fixed size. You can't keep on changing the size of a page. Fixed size pages are loaded from the main memory and all the activities are performed on those fixed size pages. Are you getting what I'm trying to say? So paging is a faster process as compared to segmentation, because paging allows physical addresses of a process to be present at non-continuous locations. Over in this case, these are continuous locations in segmentation, but in paging, there is non-continuous locations, because one page can be present at the starting of the entire page table. One may be present on some other page table. You're getting what I'm trying to say? There has to be some kind of a relation between a logical memory and physical memory. So that is done with the help of pages. So check this diagram once again. Instead of segment name and offset, we are providing with something which is called as page name, or we can say page number, comma offset. The concept is same. There is a page table. CPU wants to refer a particular page. What it does is it will simply send a instruction which will consist of this type. For example, let me take an example over here. The CPU wishes to send something like this. 3, comma offset could be 1000, whatever, or 0000. So what should happen is the page number is 3. So in this case, a third page will be found out. Okay. And that third page ka location will be checked. That location is nothing but the base address. Okay, so I'm repeating once again. Page number is used as an index into a page table. This particular page number is used as an index into the page table, which contains the base address of each pages. This particular table is similar to this table over here. Segmentation ka jo table tha. It is similar to this. Okay. Try to correlate. The CPU will point to this particular page table. The page table will be having all the base addresses of all the pages. Clear? Clear with this? Next, what happens is the page offset, that is this value, is added with the base address which we obtained from here. That is this particular value. Are you understanding or is it confusing? I'm repeating once again. This page number, that is this combination, okay, this combination could be found out from here. That is, if we send a page number, that page number will be found out in this table, and this table is again divided into two entries, okay, a base address. Basically, this base address is nothing but this value, sorry, this D value. This D value is added with the base address offset address present over here. Kind of confusing. Let me repeat it once again. It is page and offset, and it is frame and offset, if I'm not wrong. Okay. So what is happening is this particular page number, for example, 3, is being pointed over here at third location, and at this third location, we will get the frame offset. So we are going to add the page offset and the frame offset. We are going to add that, and whichever location comes out as a result, there you will get the particular page. Now, is it clear? Kindly let me know, or if you want one more explanation of this. Kindly let me know. It's kind of confusing, or if you require one more explanation, I will give it.
Understood, sir.
Okay. What about others? Because we are having two concepts over here, page and offset, and similarly, frame and offset. Okay, so what happens is this particular page value is checked in this table. At that particular intersection, we will get one frame offset. So we will add this page offset and this frame offset, and whatever is the new value, that is the actual location of my particular page. So is it clear now? This can be a hexadecimal address, or it can be a base 64 address. It depends upon the operating system which is being used. Okay, so if it is clear, then I can stop over here. If you are having any doubts, we are still having 5 minutes. Kindly let me know.